Well, good morning, everybody. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and let us be glad in it. Amen. Well, welcome to Zion here in beautiful Chelsea, Michigan. We're excited that you're with us this morning. Today is Palm Sunday, and it's a kickoff to Holy Week. And during Palm Sunday, or at Palm Sunday, we celebrate Jesus' triumphal entry into the city of Jerusalem, where they hailed him the Messiah and the King. So we're going to be doing that here as we begin a Holy Week, and it's going to be a wonderful worship service. So grab your cup of coffee. Thank you for joining us. And remember, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We continue with the blessing of the palms.
A reading from the Gospel of John in the 12th chapter. The next day, the great crowd that had come to the festival heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, for it is written, "Do not be afraid, daughter of Zion. Look, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written of him and had been done to him. So the crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead, continued to testify. It was also because they heard that he had performed this sign that the crowd went to meet him. The Pharisees then said to one another, "You see, you can do nothing. Look, the world has gone after him." The Gospel of the Lord. This is Palm Sunday, and even though you can't be here, we want to bless the palms and bless you. So let's pray. Father in heaven, please bless these palms that we use in worship today. Bless those who carry them. Bless those who are at home or watching the video who wish they could be carrying them. Knit us together in the community of people cheering for Hosanna, for our King of Israel. Guide us, guard us, and keep us during this Holy Week, that we may walk the path with Jesus, the walk through sorrows to death to resurrection. Amen.
Hosanna,
Continue with the call to worship. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Praise to Christ who comes as Messiah and Savior of the world. He is King of kings and Lord of lords. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. He is our rock. He is our King. And we shout praise to the living Christ who comes to rescue us from sin and death, giving us life and freedom. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
I'm From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea. Creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring. Every creature unique in the song that it sings. All exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All-powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go? Or seen heavenly storehouses laid in to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, struck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you
Let us pray. God of love and God of compassion and God of mercy, the one who provides, the one who saves us. As we gather together on this Palm Sunday, this Passion Sunday, we, like those folks so long ago, shout, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest, which means God save us. We know that this has been a challenging year, and we're grateful that we have a Messiah, that we have a King who loves us deeply, and his name is Jesus, and he rescues us. Thank you for giving him to us to love. We know that he loves and cares about us deeply. We also, Lord, know that at times we can be unfaithful and we can turn our backs on the one that we call Lord, the one that we call Messiah and King. But you are a God of mercy and a God of grace. As we enter this holy season of Holy Week, let us be mindful of all the things that you have done for us and the depths of your love for us as we journey to that Maundy Thursday where we celebrate that meal of communion, that Passover meal, and we understand then what it means to love in acts of kindness and service. And then also at the foot of the cross where we are forgiven and given new life. And then the empty tomb, Easter, where we celebrate Christ's victory over death. Bless us, Lord, as we gather here. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. A little boy was sick on Palm Sunday and had to stay home from church with his mom. When his dad returned home from the service, he was holding a palm branch. And the little boy, being curious, asked his dad, "Hey, Dad, like, why do you have that palm branch in your hand?" And the father said, "Well, son, when Jesus came into town, everyone was waving palm branches to honor him." The little guy thought for a minute and said, "Wouldn't you know, Dad, I missed church 1 week and Jesus shows up." Well, this morning we celebrate Palm Sunday, Sunday of the Passion, which marks the beginning of Holy Week with Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. And it's here in the beginning where the crowds and the paparazzi gathered in great anticipation to get a glimpse of Jesus so they could welcome him and hail him as the promised Messiah, the Savior, the Anointed One, the one the prophets said would come. Jesus was, for them, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Many of the folks who gathered in Jerusalem for this ticker tape parade celebration had heard about Jesus and his teachings. And many of them, in fact, had been eyewitnesses of Jesus' miracles. They experienced the feeding of the 5,000. They witnessed the raising up of Lazarus. They saw lepers, women, and children being healed. They heard the greatest sermon of all, where Jesus challenged those who were listening about life issues, like loving your enemy and praying for those who hurt you and being peacemakers and peacekeepers and working for justice and learning how to give and to share, not having a critical and judgmental heart, not worrying about life, but rather how we need to trust in God and that God's kingdom is near and that God's a loving and caring and forgiving God. And so they wanted to welcome Jesus, like you would a conquering hero or rock star. And they did it with shouts of, "Hosanna, Hosanna," which means, "Save us now." These folks who gathered there for that great parade had great hopes and dreams of their new Messiah that would usher in this new age. Palm Sunday, or Sunday of the Passion, as it's sometimes said, is a very interesting celebration because of the emotion of it and the rhythm that we feel as we gather this day. However, when we really think about it, it's really, I think, an accurate reflection of how life is. Because as we know, life is filled with emotional rhythms, wouldn't you say? Life can be a celebration where we experience a hope and joy and peace. But then, as we know, it can quickly turn to tragedy or betrayal, rejection, doubt, death. I mean, that's life. Life can be that way. This day and this week is a story about us and the real stuff of life. It's our story. And how we and how our life can get really a messy when we stray from God and do things our way. It reflects you and me and all of the joys and the triumphs and tragedies and struggles and uncertainties and disappointments of life itself. Political turmoil, injustice, hatred, racial tension, poverty, genocide, physical, mental, and spiritual anguish, unbelief, rejection, insecurity, self-rejection, relational brokenness, uncertain futures, pride, pain, suffering, loneliness. I mean, it's all there in this week. And it's us, isn't it? However, the good news is that this story is also a story of great hope and God's redemption and his love for you and me. It is the central story of our faith. It's a story that reminds all of us how much we matter to God and the extent that God has gone to show us his love. It's a reminder that God never turns his back on us in spite of our unfaithfulness, and that what God did on that blood-stained cross some 2,000 years ago was for you and for me. Palm Sunday, the Passion of the Christ, this week reminds us that in the midst of uncertainty and despair, folks, there is hope. And that in the midst of sin, you know, the stuff that messes us up, our relationship with God, a relationship with others, that there is forgiveness. And that in the midst of separation, there is reconciliation. And that in the midst of death, there is life. Because as we know, as this week unfolds, we realize that we worship a God who, check this out, turns tragedies into triumphs. That's Easter. So with that being said, as we journey to the cross this morning and ultimately to the empty tomb, what does this week actually tell us about God, about God's nature, about God's character, his heart, and how God feels about you and me?
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Now the festival of unleavened bread, which is called the Passover, was near. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to put Jesus to death, for they were afraid of the people. Then Satan entered into Judas, called Iscariot, who was one of the 12. He went away and conferred with the chief priests and officers of the temple police about how he might betray Jesus to them. They were greatly pleased and agreed to give him money. So he consented and began to look for an opportunity to betray him to them when no crowd was present. Then came the day of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. So Jesus sent Peter and John, saying,
"Go and prepare the Passover meal for us, that we may eat it."
They asked him,
"Where do you want us to make preparations for it?"
Jesus said, "Listen, when you have entered the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him into the house he enters and say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks you, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples. He will show you a large room upstairs, already furnished. Make preparations for us there."
So they went and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When the hour came, he took his place at the table, and the apostles with him. He said to them,
"I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God."
Then he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he said,
"Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes."
Then he took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying,
"This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
And he did the same with the cup after supper, saying,
"This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But see, the one who betrays me is with me, and his hand is on the table. For the Son of Man is going as it has been determined, but woe to that one by whom he is betrayed."
Then they began to ask one another which one of them it could be who would do this. A dispute also arose among them as to which one of them was to be regarded as the greatest. But he said to them,
"The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you, just as my Father conferred on me, a kingdom, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, listen. Satan has demanded to sift all of you like wheat, but I have prayed for you that your own faith may not fail, and you, once you have turned back, strengthen your brothers."
And Peter said to him,
"Lord, I am ready to go with you to prison and to death."
Jesus said,
"I tell you, Peter, the cock will not crow this day until you have denied three times that you know me."
He said to them,
"When I sent you out without a purse, bag, or sandals, did you lack anything?" "No, not a thing."
He said to them,
"But now the one who has a purse must take it, and likewise a bag. And the one who has no sword must sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you, this scripture must be fulfilled in me, 'And he was counted among the lawless.' And indeed, what is written about me may be fulfilled."
They said,
"Lord, look, here are two swords."
He replied,
"It is enough."
He came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them,
"Pray that you may not come into the time of trial."
Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down, and prayed,
"Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done."
Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down on the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them,
"Why are you sleeping? get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial.
While he was still speaking, suddenly a crowd came, and then one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him,
Judas, is it with a kiss that you are betraying the Son of Man?
When those who were around him saw what was coming, they asked,
Lord, should we strike with the sword?
Then one of them struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said,
no more of that.
And he touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple police, and the elders who had come for him,
have you come out with swords and clubs as if I were a bandit? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness.
Then they seized him and led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house. But Peter was following at a distance. When they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at him and said,
this man was also with him.
But he denied it, saying,
woman, I do not know him.
A little later, someone else, on seeing him, said,
you are also one of them.
But Peter said,
man, I am not.
Then about an hour later, still, another kept insisting,
surely this man was also with him, for he is a Galilean.
But Peter said,
man, I do not know what you are talking about.
At that moment, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times. And he went out and wept bitterly. Now the men who were holding Jesus began to mock him and beat him. They also blindfolded him and kept asking him,
prophesy, who is it that struck you?
They kept heaping many other insults on him. When day came, the assembly of the elders of the people, both chief priests and scribes, gathered together, and they brought him to their council. They said,
if you are the Messiah, tell us.
He replied,
if I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God.
All of them asked,
are you then the Son of God?
He said to them,
you say that I am.
Then they said,
what further testimony do we need? We have heard it ourselves from his own lips.
Then the assembly rose as a body and brought Jesus before Pilate. They began to accuse him, saying,
we have found this man perverting our nation, forbidding us to pay taxes to the emperor, and saying that he himself is the Messiah, a king.
Then Pilate asked him,
are you the king of the Jews?
He answered,
you say so.
Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowds,
I find no basis for an accusation against this man.
But they were insistent and said,
he stirs up the people by teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee, where he began, even to this place.
When Pilate heard this, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And when he learned that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him off to Herod, who was himself in Jerusalem at the time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad, for he had been waiting to see him for a long time, because he had heard about him and was hoping to see him perform some sign. He questioned him at some length, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the scribes stood by, venomingly accusing him. Even Herod, with his soldiers, treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then he put an elegant robe on him and sent him back to Pilate. That same day, Herod and Pilate became friends with each other. Before this, they had been enemies. Pilate then called together the chief priests, the leaders, the people, and said to them,
"You brought this man as one who is perverting the people, and here I have examined him in your presence and have not found this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to Lys. Indeed, he has done nothing to deserve death. I will therefore have him flogged and release him."
Then they all shouted out together,
"Away with this fellow. Release Barabbas for us."
This was a man who had been put in prison for an insurrection that had taken place in the city and for murder. Pilate, wanting to release Jesus, addressed them again, but they kept shouting,
"Crucify! Crucify him!"
A third time, Pilate said to them,
"Why? What evil has he done? I have found in him no ground for the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and then release him."
But they kept urgently demanding with low shouts that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave his verdict that their demand should be granted. He released the man they asked for, the one who had been put in prison for insurrection and murder, and he handed Jesus over as they wished. As they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country, and they laid the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of the people followed him, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said,
"Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and your children. For the days are surely coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' And then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?"
Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said,
"Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing."
And they cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying,
"He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one."
The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying,
"You are the King of the Jews. Save yourself."
There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying,
"Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us."
But the other rebuked him, saying,
"Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? and we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong."
Then he said,
"Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom."
Jesus replied,
"Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise."
It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. While the sun's light faded, the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said,
"Father, into your hands I commend my spirit."
Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said,
"Certainly, this man was innocent."
And when all the crowds who had gathered there for this spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home, beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. Now there was a good and righteous man named Joseph, who, though a member of the council, had not agreed to their plan and action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea, and he was waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in a linen cloth, and laid it in a rock-hewn tomb where no one had ever been laid. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The women who had come with him from Galilee followed, and they saw the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and ointments. On the Sabbath, they rested according to the commandment.
Thank you.
Let us join our hearts together in the prayers of intercession. I will end each petition with, "Hear us, O God," and I invite you to respond, "Your mercy is great." Creator of seasons, thank you for spring and new life. Nourish seedlings, keep safe all who plant or prepare the soil. Thank you for parents of young children who are new life, born of your love for us. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Comforter in times of grief, we mourn together the loss of those killed in shootings across our country this week. Send your holying spirit to all those who are grieving, the grieving family and friends. Help us to resist evil, to resist hate, violence, and prejudice, to spread the gospel of love in Jesus' name. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Healer of our every ill, hope of each tomorrow, we lift up those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Today we lift up especially Michaela Statler, our minister of music here at Zion, Pastor John Morris, a past pastor of Zion who is in the hospital, Pastor Lauren Kirsch-Carr on our synod staff who is recovering at home. We lift up those on our prayer list and those whom we name now aloud or silently. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Good Shepherd, our state and our county are seeing more cases of COVID-19. Guard and guide those who are delivering shots and those who are receiving them. Sustain our hope, even in the case of increased numbers. Sustain this hope that we may support each other, fellow sheep in your flock, Good Shepherd. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. For these things and all other things you know that we need, we lift up our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Yes, God's peace be with you during this Holy Week. Hey, I just want to thank you so much for your continued support here at Zion, for your generosity, for the sharing of your time, your talents, and just your possessions. And I know that the leadership here also thanks you. If you want to continue to give to our ministry, you can mail it in, you can drop it off here at the church, or you can go to our website and hit the donate button. But the most important thing, the Lord says that he wants us to give with a joyful heart. Yes, because we're making a difference when we give and we share. Let's prepare our hearts for communion. Lord God, you are indeed holy and almighty and merciful. You are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. Lord, you so loved the world that you gave your only begotten Son, Jesus, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Having come into this world, he fulfilled for us your holy will and accomplished for us your salvation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Thank you, Jesus. Again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks, and he gave it for all of them to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people. It's for the forgiveness of their sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, and his glorious resurrection and ascension, and his promise to come again. We give thanks to you, Lord Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. And we ask you, mercifully, Lord, to accept our praise and our thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit, to bless us, your people, and these, your own gifts of bread and wine, that we and all who share in the body and blood of your Son, Jesus, may be filled with a heavenly peace and joy and receiving the forgiveness of sins. May he sanctify us, mind, body, soul, and spirit. It's in his mighty name that we pray. And Lord, as we gather here, thank you for teaching us how to pray. And together we pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We're going to continue to commune, and hopefully you have some bread, you have some wine or some grape juice. And just remember that though you might not be here, we are here virtually. And what unites all of us together is the body of Christ, is Jesus. Jesus, his love, binds all of us together. We continue with communion. Remember, this is his body and it's his blood given and shed for you. We continue with communion.
When the best of me is barely breathing, when I'm not somebody I believe in, hold on to me. When I miss the light the night has stolen, when I'm slamming all the doors you've opened, hold on to me.
We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. And we pray that in your mercy, you would strengthen us through this gift in faith towards you and in fervent love toward one another, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.